Now calling the Association Secretary and General Counsel, Major General Joe Lynch, to confirm that he's kept us in compliance with Virginia law regarding the meeting, as well as to submit the proxy report. General Lynch?
Thank you, sir. As required by Virginia law, we sent printed and digital copies of the notice of the MOAA 2016 annual meeting, together with a ballot and proxy card, to the last known address or email address of each and every voting member of the association. Of these, 39,977 were returned by postal mail or by internet prior to the deadline of August 31st. Of the returned proxies, over 36,000 or more than 91%, were assigned to the board of directors, and some 480, or just over 1%, were assigned to other individuals. Should proxy holders who are in attendance today be called upon to vote their assigned proxies, they will be identified and polled at the appropriate time. Mr. Chairman, that completes the proxy report.
Thank you, Joe. The proxy report is approved, and with those legal matters out of the way, I hereby declare that this annual meeting of the membership of MOAA is legally constituted. I also note for the record that the minutes of our last year's annual meeting held in Orlando, Florida, were approved by the Board of Directors on April 12th of this year. And just out of curiosity, show of hands, how many of you were at the annual meeting in Orlando last year? Hoo-ah. And I'm not even a Marine. Congratulations. So, it's now both, I do know the song though. It's now both my responsibility and my pleasure to report to you. I'd like to take a few minutes to touch on a couple of significant developments in MOAA over the past year. First, if you haven't noticed, we've had a significant change in leadership. This past January, Vice Admiral Nora Bryan retired after serving as MOAA President and CEO for over 13 years. As most of you here know, or certainly should know, by the time Norb retired, he was an absolute institution unto himself in the D.C. area. So I knew walking in the door as chairman that one of my biggest challenges was going to be to conduct a search to find, to select, and secure Norb's successor. Well, I'm very pleased to report, as a result of a nationwide search and a very methodical screening and selection process, that we were able to select Lieutenant General Dana Atkins, U.S. Air Force retired, as MOAA's new president and CEO. Dana had a distinguished Air Force career with a number of important command assignments, including commander of 11th Air Force in Alaska. When he retired in 2012, he moved to Augusta. That's in Georgia. And became president of a large Georgia multimedia corporation. We consider ourselves extremely fortunate to have found and hired Dana as our new president. With Dana, we have an individual with a proven leadership record, with experience as a private sector company president, and extensive expertise in communications and communications technology. Your board of directors and I felt that this was the essential additional skill set we needed to most guarantee MOAA's continued recruiting success in today's highly competitive market. After 10 months on the job, I'll tell you, we couldn't be more pleased with Dana's energy, his leadership, and his passion for MOAA and our mission. He hit the ground running. He's already been to dozens of chapters and met you on your own turf and talked to you about MOAA. And I'll tell you, he's having a real positive impact throughout the organization. Now, since coming on board, we didn't let him have a nice, easy ride when he walked through the door. Dana and the staff have had to tackle a number of challenging issues. If you don't know, and I'll let Jim O'Brien correct me for the record, MOAA generates its operating income from four essential sources: membership dues, advertising, royalties, and the return on what we have is a significant corpus invested in a very diverse portfolio in the market. When we closed out 2015, the board started to get concerned about the extreme volatility that was starting to affect the U.S. stock market, especially given that our investments just weren't delivering the returns that we were expecting or that we planned for or were expecting. Under Dana's leadership and the leadership of Jim O'Brien, the red-headed Irishman down there, our CFO, we conducted, I would say, a long overdue bottoms-up review, I'm sure you've heard that term before, of all of MOAA's programs to validate them against our mission and then prioritize them based on their relative contribution to MOAA's membership and our revenue. I won't drag you through the details except to say that as a result of that review, we have moved from what was to be a $680,000 budget shortfall in 2016, $680,000 budget shortfall, to a projected surplus for 2017. Now, part of that's due to better returns and stabilization in the market. But I'll tell you, the real saving came from prioritizing our programs and eliminating costs that didn't directly contribute to MOAA's strategic mission. Put simply, we have a much stronger and much more fiscally stable organization today as a result of this effort. And I'll flip around real quick and say, we still have work to do. I suspect this process of stabilizing our income and our outgo will probably take 2 to 4 more years. But we've taken the biggest step, the most important step, to get us in the black and moving forward positively. But we want to get more healthy as we go forward, and the board is taking that on. Now, getting the business running properly is important, but where MOAA really delivers value to our members is through our advocacy efforts. Over the past year, Dana's taken the stick to strengthen our relationships on Capitol Hill with the Department of Defense and with the Veterans Administration. He's gone a long way with Steve Strobridge with numerous meetings with key leadership in each of those organizations along with the Armed Services Committees and their staffs. That's the good news, but I'd be totally Pollyannish if I didn't hasten to add that we've still got our work cut out for us. Steve Strobridge can tell you a lot better than I can, and you could pull out my script from last year and I'll use the same paragraph. We face another year of an active duty pay increase that's capped below the employment cost index. The Senate's proposed drastic cuts in basic allowance for housing, reducing the benefit by as much as $30,000 for many service members living off base. We were successful in defeating a proposal to means test TRICARE for life, but retirees below the age of 65 are going to see significant increases in TRICARE and prescription copays. With Steve Strobridge preparing to retire again, you know that Steve retired and then came back because we had a significant gap in the leadership of government relations. He's going to retire again, and we were pleased to be able to recruit Air Force Colonel Dan Mary to take over our Government Relations Department. Dan has already been on board with Steve for several months. Steve's going to hang around for a couple of more months to cross flow. And Dan, I think Dan, and if you haven't met him, you need to. Dan, are you here? Please. Dan Mary, folks. The next reincarnation of Steve Strobridge. Please shake his hand, but I think we have secured the strong and effective leadership we need in this critical era of MOAA's business. Now, we've been paying particular attention to councils and chapters, and that focus will only increase, I think, as we go forward. To take the burden off of our local chapter volunteers, just to list two initiatives, we've developed a white label newsletter that the chapters can use the content from. They're prepared to cover national issues, and then they add their own masthead and issues. That are important to local members. We're stepping up our series of webinars also to assist our chapters in recruiting and financial management and adopting best practices. Finally, I'm sad to announce, and I don't say that lightly, that this week marks the end of my service and my class's service to the MOAA's Board of Directors. Serving as a member of this board for the past 6 years and as chairman for the past 2 years, to put it mildly, has been tremendously rewarding and gratifying. It's been a bittersweet week for us, but the good news is that the dozen new board members that are taking our place on the board are absolutely incredible. They, like you and I, know in their hearts that the men and women who are serving our country in uniform need our continued full-time support. They know in their hearts that our severely wounded service members and their caregivers look to MOAA for financial advice and assistance in everyday life. They know in their hearts that service members who are nearing retirement look to MOAA to assist in their transition to civilian careers, that they look to MOAA to help them with career opportunities for their spouses, and they look to MOAA for financial support for their children when they head to college. And finally, they know in their hearts that service members are genuinely grateful for what you and your organization does for them every day. I am truly honored and grateful to have been able to give my all to MOAA, to this important mission, for the past 6 years. Now I'll just return and be a normal old chapter guy, and that's okay too. But I promise you, you're going to be delighted with your new chairman, and you're going to be delighted with our new board members after we install them later this morning. So in closing, I offer my heartfelt thanks to many people, to my board colleagues you saw stand up earlier, in particular to my vice chairman, Lieutenant General Randy Rigby, Lieutenant General Mike Rochelle, and Colonel Eric Chase. They and all of the members of this board have contributed an incredible amount of time, talent, and energy to this organization, and it shows. To our president and to each member of MOAA's superb headquarters staff, would the headquarters staff please stand? I thank each of you for what you do each and every day and demonstrating that you are why you're regarded as, and there's no other way to say it, the absolute best in the business. You're MOAA's secret weapon, and we're truly fortunate to have every one of you. I also want to convey a special thanks to our board and staff spouses. They're our hidden weapon. I said it last night, and I'll say it again. They have been wonderful ambassadors for MOAA, and their efforts have truly supported and advanced our mission. And most importantly, I thank in each and every one of you, each and every MOAA member in this room and around the world today, for what you do both as individuals and through our system of councils and chapters. You're the ones who make it possible for our association to serve our entire military community, and it's been a true privilege, and I look forward to continuing to work with each and every one of you. We'll now hear for our president, the part you've really been waiting for, Lieutenant General Dana Atkins.
Let's take a look at this.
At the Military Officers Association of America, we're often asked, why should I join MOAA? What's in it for me? First, our members feel a lifetime bond of officership. We take care of our troops and their families. MOAA is the largest and most influential military service organization in the country. MOAA provides world-class financial education and transition assistance. In 2015 alone, we helped 2,000 military officers and spouses. The MOAA Scholarship Fund has helped more than 14,000 military children get a college education. More than 400 chapters across the country lead in giving back to the community. Most of all, MOAA leads the way in protecting your interests on Capitol Hill. We advocate on behalf of the entire military community. Did you know a 2014 budget law imposed a huge cost of living adjustment cut? For current and future military retirees, it meant $120,000 less in lifetime retired pay for an O5. You won't feel that pain because MOAA got it repealed and put that money back in your pocket. But that's history. In the current budget crunch, the big defense issue is people versus weapons. The Pentagon's strong hardware push is backed by big industry lobbying contributions, and that puts troop levels, pay, housing, healthcare, and more under constant attack. You know that. You hear it all the time. Well, it's MOAA that's pushing back to defend those programs, because that's what officers do. We stand up and lead from the front to defend our comrades in arms. But fighting those battles takes resources, and that means membership. MOAA's past campaigns have been funded mainly by dues contributions of officers from the World War II, Korea, and Vietnam eras. Without increased contributions from all generations, all those past gains are at risk. That's how we answer, what's in it for me? If you believe, as we do, that taking care of our troops is a lifetime commitment, if you believe, as we do, that currently serving and retired personnel and their families and survivors need you in their corner as never before, then join MOAA now, because your voice and your support will make all the difference.
That's a pretty strong message, right? If you believe, like we believe, and I think everybody in this room does believe, what MOAA does for certainly all of us and our military families and those serving today. Well, good morning, and as I begin my first presentation to a MOAA annual meeting, I need to acknowledge that I am, I guess, now the ninth president following Admiral Ryan. I honestly believe Admiral Ryan served. Notably, many of you in this room don't know that in 2014, he was recognized as the outstanding president CEO of a nonprofit association in the nation. He truly was a rock star, so I knew I had some big shoes to fill. Well, I came to MOAA after a long and fulfilling career as a fighter pilot and serving nearly 35 years in the Air Force. When I was chained to a desk, I was always yearning to get back and serve with the young men and women who make uncommon sacrifice a common virtue. Now, after leaving active duty in 2012, I worked in a publishing business for 4 years, leading a Southeast-based media company. Now, this experience for me is particularly valuable as I work with the MOAA Board of Directors and our leadership team to address a number of challenges that we face as an association and as a military community. For me, challenges always inspire new energies, and I'm grateful to be working with such an impressive board, a headquarters staff, and chapter leaders. Our team does remarkable work, and I feel a renewed sense of determination to move ahead in our shared commitment to take stock, make adjustments, and build on our strengths. A major part of my work this past year has focused on people, on relationships, and on delivering member value, as well as building and strengthening collaborative relationships with important partners in the association world, on Capitol Hill, in the administration, and within the military coalition. Now, these discussions with our key partners reinforce, in my mind, the new reality of constant change. Leadership at all levels faces a multitude of difficult choices, and I'm reminded that you can't create a better future by clinging to the past. My expanding array of Washington connections also reaffirms my inclination that we share many of the same challenges of our peer associations, specifically revenue, membership, and the need to build productive relationships with a new administration and the new congressional leadership after these fall elections. Now, these are challenges and opportunities that occupy most of my time. And I'll begin my report this morning with a review of our financial situation. Now, every new CEO has a responsibility to challenge the status quo. And as I assumed my CEO duties from Admiral Norb Ryan, our board of directors directed a bottom-up review, or a BRRR as we called it, to review all of our spending programs. The objective of the BRRR process was to ensure that our investments and membership programs directly support our core missions of advocacy, membership, council and chapter affairs, and engagement. As a new CEO, the BRRR process was a perfect opportunity for me to increase my own organizational understanding and ensure that we are managing our limited resources responsibly and effectively. After all, our first responsibility and my responsibility is to be good stewards of your money. And the Burr process, despite a slow-growing economy and a cyclical stock market, has put us in a sustainable trajectory. For example, our total spending in 2008 was about $24 million. By contrast, the 2017 budget, which was approved yesterday by our board of directors, will be around $21 million, or about a 17% reduction from 2008. And that's despite an 8% increase in the Consumer Price Index over this same period. And we still have a few months left in the year, and no one knows if the national election will be wildly bullish or wildly bearish. But I'm cautiously optimistic that we will be in decent shape by the end of this year. Now, another outcome of the Burr process was the identification and redeployment of seven of our employees to programs that have direct payoff in one of our core functions: advocacy, membership, councils and chapters, engagement, and resource management. Now, to help us identify where additional talent needs to be focused, and with special assistance for our new public affairs officer, retired National Guard Colonel Bob Ditchie, we formalized our commitments to you and our board of directors in a revised strategic plan, which identifies specific objectives in each of our core functions. We plan to share this new strategic plan later on our website early next year. Now, along with sustainable finances and a revised strategic plan, we have also made important changes this year to align the leadership team under seven talented, hardworking vice presidents. I don't view this adjustment as a new guy making an imprint on the organization, but rather as a renewed focus on the essential elements of organizational success: membership, government relations, member support, communications, finance and operations, development, and information technology. And this arrangement also provides me with one belly button in each critical area of organizational success, and I believe allows us to execute more effectively, more efficiently, and with greater collaboration across our entire enterprise. Now, this streamlined leadership structure has allowed us the flexibility to add talent in areas critical to our organizational success, such as deeper digital and video expertise and additional social media savvy. I think you would agree that any successful team needs veterans who understand the culture and retain valuable corporate knowledge, along with new draft choices that bring fresh ideas and new perspectives to complement our lineup in critical areas of organizational success. I'm happy to report that our team was strengthened this year with the arrival of a number of new staff members, including our new Vice President of Government Relations, Dan Mary, who you've just met. And also, we welcome a new network of system administrators, a new creative director, and many new faces within our communications group's art, production, and editorial teams. We have also added key staff in our facilities maintenance, transition center, marketing, content generation teams, all who are highlighted on this slide. Now, another important course adjustment this year is our strengthened array of relationships within the administration and Congress to support our advocacy effectiveness. I've had excellent meetings with Vice Admiral Bono, who's the director of the Defense Health Agency, and Steve Strobridge, Dan Mary, and Kathy Beasley from our government relations team have had equally productive meetings with the DHA staff. Prominent among our strengthened relationship is what I consider to be enhanced collaboration with the Veterans Affairs Secretary, Bob McDonald. Now, many of you in this room may have strong opinions about Secretary McDonald, but I firmly believe he is committed to fixing access issues and rebuilding trust within the veteran community, while at the same time navigating the political landscape. Now, he characterizes his work as trying to create irreversible momentum to change the culture of the VA. And I'm pleased to report that he has recently expanded his regular meetings with the group of six VSOs to the group of seven, which includes MOAA at the table. Our VA access also extends to regular working level engagement in areas of great importance to our membership, including VA claims processing and the appeals process, and important discussions on VA health care. I also had a very good meeting with Senator Lindsey Graham, who chairs the Senate Armed Services Personnel Subcommittee, and other key leaders on Capitol Hill. from our weekly legislative updates and Washington Scene essays and Military Officer magazine, you know we have been working all year to moderate some of the President's budget proposals in the National Defense Authorization Act. Now, these troublesome proposals include fourth consecutive pay raise caps for the currently serving, another year of housing allowance reductions, major TRICARE fee hikes, means-tested enrollment fees for TRICARE for Life, and additional threats to our commissary system. We succeeded in defeating the TRICARE for Life means testing, as well as the immediate commissary privatization threat, even before these issues went to committee. But we encountered new challenges with proposals to cut housing allowance by about $10,000 to $30,000 per year, depending on what geographic location you reside. We also invested a considerable effort in one of our key storming issues, seeking more relief from the military widow's tax. Usually at this time of the year, we can report on the results of our efforts. Unfortunately, Congress went into their election recess without finishing the defense bill. Although we do know that next year's COLA will only be 0.3%, it's better than last year's 0%, but not by much. In a recent article authored by Steve Strobridge, he called this Diet COLA. From what we understand, Armed Services Committee leaders have worked out most of their differences and expect final action on the defense bill in the lame duck session after this election. While there are never any guarantees, we're hoping the indications of early agreement will mean that they took some positive action on plussing up force levels, military pay raises, avoiding disproportional TRICARE fee hikes, and extending the Special Survivor Indemnity Allowance for SBP-DIC survivors. At the very least, we expect to see multiple changes to improve healthcare access, continuity, and the overall quality for military beneficiaries. One way or another, no matter who gets elected, we think Congress also will work out a deal to keep the government funded for the new fiscal year. All in all, the best thing about the lame duck session is it means that this election cycle is over. Transitioning to our second key pillar, membership and marketing, and with help from Kathy Parton and her group, we have launched important new relationships with General Hamm at AUSA and General Spencer at AFA. We have also deepened our relationship with USAA and finalized our plans for integrating the officer members of the National Association for Uniformed Services into our ranks in early 2017. Now, all of these efforts have allowed us to maintain steady membership levels in all of our membership categories in recent months, although paid membership remains one of our biggest challenges. At the end of 2015, we stood at 390,000 members strong. We'll recognize some losses by the end of the year, but we are working diligently to acquire more members and retain those already on our membership rolls. And we are laser focused on providing personalized and relevant experiences to each and every member. And as you can imagine, that's a challenging task when you consider we have members from age 22 to 102 who each have different needs. You'll begin to see more content tailored to your interest, all designed to engage you more, create a dialogue between members with and without MOAA. You've heard it before. Engaged members tend to be retained members. One of our key focus areas continues to be bringing young officers into our fold. The membership model with our free basic membership gives us a great way to expose these young officers to membership. I hope you are taking full advantage of this as you talk with those young officers. Once in the fold, we can work to cultivate them into lifelong members. We're also growing many new life members. Our most recent direct mail and email campaign has generated more than 900 new life members in just 5 weeks, far exceeding the performance of past campaigns. Recalling the membership development email that you received last month, I urge all of you to share our success stories described in the Why MOAA video that you just reviewed this morning. On a personal level, I've had great success asking eligible family members and friends to join MOAA. In fact, I casually say I'm 10 for 10 in my membership development work. Whenever I connect with people, I always ask whether they are familiar with MOAA and the great work that we support in the military community. Too often the answer that I hear is no or only vaguely. After a brief discussion highlighting our many successes, I always ask if they would consider joining, and I invariably end up recruiting a new premium or life member. A membership is hard work, but it also is exciting. At the national level, we never stop testing, learning, and looking for the next best way to communicate with current and prospective members, whether it's through digital or more traditional communication channels. I know you're working hard out in your own local communities too, and for that, I say thank you. Now that we are here to help and assist you in membership and know that we are here to help you and assist you in membership and development efforts. Cultivating and empowering our nationwide network of more than 400 chapters is an important component of our membership and advocacy strategies. Many of our chapters are doing impactful work in their local communities, and I'm pleased that we recognize 180 of our best performing chapters at last night's Levels of Excellence dinner. However, since arriving at MOAA and spending time with a number of our chapter leaders, I have found they need additional support to help with the challenges of communication, revenue, and recruitment. Our goal is to enable all of our chapters to offer camaraderie with a purpose in their local communities and to help chapters connect with currently serving, retired, and former officers. To further this goal, Kate Maloney in our communications group was instrumental in designing the white label newsletter template to help our chapters communicate more effectively with their members. Each month, the MOAA headquarters staff will update an online-only template consisting of news and important information to strengthen our grassroots networks and stimulate communications with Congress. We will leave about 25% of the edible space for chapters, local news, and promotional information. We expect to pilot the white label newsletter template with about 6 to 7 chapters starting this month. I'm also working to build a more intimate relationship with all of our council and chapter leaders through more frequent and personalized communication prior to every MOAA visit. Between our council and chapter affairs, staff, and me, we visit more than 140 councils and chapters annually. And our goal is to make this visit more productive by better understanding your challenges and concerns in advance of our visits. One of the most gratifying comments that I hear from leaders came from our recent Chapter Leadership Development Symposium in Las Vegas, expressing sincere appreciation for the engagement of the headquarters staff to support our local chapters and councils. Nevertheless, I've challenged the Council and Chapter Affairs headquarters team to look for new strategies, to share best practices, and bring all of our chapters up to the same level of our award-winning chapters you saw last night. Focus group analysis and member feedback consistently indicate a need to deepen engagement with our members, potential members, and business partners. In addition to our traditional member engagement points of career transition, financial and benefits education, and military caregiver support, which in total have connected us with more than 14,000 members and potential members this year alone, we are pursuing several new engagement initiatives. Since April, we've produced 18 videos of varying complexity that have garnered over 35,000 views on YouTube. We've used video to highlight legislative actions, commemorate holidays, and participate in veterans' social media campaigns, all of which drive awareness and ultimately increase membership. Now, thanks to generous grants from Pentagon Federal Credit Union and the Democracy Fund, we have launched an impactful voter education campaign and an education initiative to increase understanding of the new military retirement plan. As you know, the new military retirement plan will shift more of the burden of retirement security from the government to the individual service member after its launch in January of 2018. Both the voter and retirement education initiatives are MOAA branded, are cash flow neutral, and allow us to connect with audiences that may not be in our normal sphere of influence. Finally, and before turning towards our future focus, it's important to highlight the success of our MOAA Military Family Initiative and Scholarship Program. Our MOAA Military Family Initiative makes an important contribution to revenue generation and helps fund MOAA programs and services that assist nearly 50,000 military families and veterans in their lifelong career development needs. The MMFI is on track this year to surpass its goal of raising $850,000 this calendar year. Now, moreover, I'm pleased to report that nearly 3,800 MOAA members have chosen to support MMFI, and nearly 154 members have pledged at least $1,000 over 5 years to become members of our Heritage Society, our highest levels of philanthropic support. I'm also thrilled to count 17 chapters and three councils, Florida, Maryland, and Louisiana, among our Heritage Society members. Now, in addition to the MOAA Foundation, the MOAA Scholarship Fund will disperse more than $9.6 million to nearly 1,800 students this academic year alone. Now, that's a 4.7% increase over the prior academic year. Since 1948, the MOAA Scholarship Fund has provided over 14,000 rising college freshmen and from military families with more than $135 million of educational assistance. Now, that's the statistics that's contributed to our recent platinum rating in GuideStar. Despite our course adjustments and the progress that we have made this year, I'm reminded that the only easy day was yesterday, and the MOAA leadership team is focused like a laser on securing our future. The challenges of membership, revenue, and relationship building will continue, regardless of what happens in November. Partisanship is increasing. Hard decisions on national spending priorities have been deferred for far too long, and the sea of goodwill that benefited a number of people in veterans programs is about to be eclipsed by the return of the sequester following a two-year hiatus. All of these events, combined with potential changes in the congressional leadership, lead me to expect that more congressional pressure in 2017 to save dollars on the back of the currently serving and veterans in our nation's uniformed services will occur. As a new administration and Congress come to town, we will be working to build collaborative relationships, educate and inform new leaders and new staff members on the need to balance between training and acquisition and protecting important people programs that are critical to maintaining readiness, as well as reminding policymakers that the need to keep faith with our previous generation of veterans. In the membership, marketing, and engagement areas, we intend to engage socially, expand our use of video to build brand awareness, strengthen our content generation capability, and blend timely reporting with our widely respected legislative analysis capabilities. We witnessed an example of our expanding content generation capability earlier this month when our new senior staff writer, Gina Harkins, reported near real time on remarks by the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Joseph Dunford, regarding the leadership lessons that he learned from Vietnam-era Marine officers. Our goal is to engage members and prospective members with content that spurs two-way engagement through a variety of media channels, including in-house products like our MOAA newsletter and third-party channels like our LinkedIn career networking group, where we share weekly career building and financial education content with nearly 29,000 MOAA members and potential members. We're also expanding our digital presence with increased social media campaigns, lead generation campaigns, and search engine marketing, the latter of which it allows us to target and retarget MOAA membership prospects and increase awareness of the MOAA brand. Moreover, we are committed to improving data analysis to better understand member behavior and determine the right product to best engage each individual. We also recognize that we need to expand and strengthen our array of member products and services in order to enhance our value proposition. Now, this will include a rejuvenated travel service, which is expected to launch in the first quarter of next year and will allow chapters to earn revenue when chapter members utilize that service. A streamlined Join MOAA process is another important priority. And Yumi Belonga from our web team, working alongside the membership team, has helped us make great strides in this area. Now, we have completed the first two steps in simplifying the online join process, and our next step involves making it easier for our staff road warriors to immediately convert MOAA prospects into MOAA paid members. You will also see more polls, surveys, and calls to action on the website, in social media, and through the MOAA media channels, all intended to increase your brand awareness and stimulate membership growth. In addition, we're planning a series of focus groups to discuss and explore website improvements, the first of which is scheduled this week under the leadership of our new digital project manager, Tegan O'Barr. We plan to use a hand-selected group of MOAA members representing each of our member personas to help us structure our formal feasibility study to evaluate website improvements. Additionally, a new advocacy online engagement tool is close to being launched. It will allow members and prospective members to continue writing letters and emails to their legislators, as is currently the case with our CAPWIS system. But this new engagement tool will also allow the association to track user engagement through our central membership database. We're also very conscious of the need to be a little less DC-centric in our member and prospective member support services. Accordingly, we will continue to look for new and innovative ways to deliver member value beyond our current series of informational webinars and live presentations on career transition and financial readiness topics, with a special emphasis on connecting with transitioning National Guard and Reserve personnel, many of whom do not receive any formal career transition support. Finally, it's important to recognize that our council and chapter system, including our Surviving Spouses National Network, represents the largest single group of MOAA members, which are easily and quickly activated to address advocacy issues. With over 400 national chapters and nearly 57,000 chapter members, I am personally committed to doing all I can to help them with their communications, revenue, and recruitment challenges. One reason I make this commitment is because our councils and chapters do so much to help MOAA build our brand and have impact in the community. An outstanding example of this effort is Operation Helping Hand in Tampa and its partnership with the James A. Haley Veterans Hospital. Started in 2004 by our Tampa, Florida chapter, this award-winning program supports wounded and injured active duty service members, veterans and their families, with emotional and financial assistance while undergoing treatment at the local VA trauma center. Services include dinners, patient and family gift bags, and direct financial assistance to families dealing with life-changing injuries. Another example of MOAA members making a difference came to my attention this past week from Boone, North Carolina, where members of the High Country chapter celebrated with their mayor and town manager the dedication of the site of the Watauga County Veterans Memorial. Now, two MOAA members, retired Colonels George Brudzinski and Ben Covington, were instrumental in bringing this project to fruition. And I'm pleased to report that Ben, after a phone call, is now one of MOAA's newest life members. I just had to ask him. And no one has worked harder to implement this strategy over the past 10 years than our current director of council and chapter affairs, Barry Wright. Barry has recently announced his plans to retire from the MOAA staff in January of 2017. And I'm indebted to Barry for the energy and enthusiasm that has characterized his work, initially as deputy director and then later as our director for the past 4 years. Now, I'm committed to building on Barry's success by continuing to provide our chapters and leadership development with development training, membership recruitment support, community service options, and adequate resources to strengthen their operations, whether they are geographically organized or virtual chapters focused on shared professional interest. If Barry's in the room, can I get Barry to stand up to be recognized? There's another rock star right there. Thanks, Barry. One particular exciting initiative to improve the financial position of our chapters with proven programs to impact the local community is the potential launch of a MOAA Council and Chapter Community Grant Program. Now, this has just been recently approved by the MMFI Board, and councils and chapters with impactful programs in areas of warrior family reintegration and military spouse career development will be encouraged to apply for grants of up to $5,000. Our objective is to encourage camaraderie with a purpose and to recognize those councils and chapters actively seeking to expand their influence, ideally with one thriving chapter in each congressional district. I anticipate the foundation will be announcing this new MOAA Council and Chapter Community Grant Program to the chapters during the next 2 months. Now, with all the work that I have described and with your continued leadership and support, we couldn't be facing a more optimistic future. That said, expect to see more integrated cooperation across our headquarters staff, a continued focus on reducing and controlling our expenses, and greater emphasis on revenue generation. We're finishing this year with improved focus and a clearer vision of the essential elements of our own success, supporting strong people programs despite the many competing national priorities, and continuing our work to attract and retain the next generation of military officers and their families as lifetime MOAA members. With your guidance and support, both of these goals are realistic and attainable. I sincerely appreciate you allowing me this privilege to lead as the President and CEO of MOAA, allowing me to come in behind somebody as competent and capable as Admiral Nordbrien was for 13 years. I promise you I will do my best, and for that, thank you.
Well, you asked for an update. I'm sure most of you knew all of that. But if you happen to take notes of things that didn't quite ring in your ear, we'll have a question and answer session, but I promise Dana will also be available when I cut it off at 9:30 or so to answer further questions. Plus, as I said, every board of directors is intimately, every member of the board of directors, every member of the staff in the room is intimately familiar with any of these questions. So please don't hesitate to grab them by the collar, jerk them aside, and ask them questions. Okay, now, I now recognize our secretary and general counsel. He's the guy that did wear a tie this morning, just so you could pick him out in the audience a little quicker. You didn't think I was going to let you get away with that, right?
You got me, sir.
I now call on our secretary and general counsel to report on this year's balloting on resolutions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This year's resolution committee was chaired by Major General Buck Marr, with the following members: Commander Pat Kusiak, Rear Admiral Kathleen Dussault, Lieutenant Colonel Juan Crockett, Brigadier General Dave Price, Commander John Chernosky, and Lieutenant General Ed Hanlon. When they met pursuant to your appointing order, they recommended that the board approve 14 resolutions, and the board did so. These resolutions were then presented to the voting membership of MOAA on the ballot this past summer, and over 40,000 MOAA members voted on these resolutions. The resolutions received at least 94% of the vote in each case, and in many instances exceeded 94%. We had an overall participation rate of 11% of our members voting. Mr. Chairman, that's my report.
And like you, I raised my eyebrows at the 11%. But actually, that's kind of high compared to what our membership normally responds, and it's kind of high compared to what other organizations get on votes from the membership. But thank you, sir. I now call upon the secretary one more time to present the report of this year's board nominating committee and the results of that balloting.
Mr. Chairman, the 2016 board nominating committee, elected by the board of directors pursuant to the association's bylaws and your direction, included one officer from each of the seven uniformed services. Also, in accordance with the bylaws, these officers were neither members of the board of directors nor members of the staff. They were charged to select nominees to fill prospective vacancies on the board and to provide a slate of nominees for submission to the membership for their consideration. The committee met on Tuesday, April 26, 2016, in Alexandria, Virginia, and reviewed very carefully the professional and personal qualifications of all candidates seeking nomination to our board. The committee's selections were based on our bylaws and by the criteria developed by you and directed by you for their selection. I now invite everyone's attention to the program, which lists the 11 directors elect, and I report to you that each nominee received at least 98% of the votes that were cast. Mr. Chairman, as you know, we normally nominate 12 directors every 2 years to fill vacancies on the board of directors. This year, we nominated only 11. And the reason we did that is because the four-star nominee was continued to be on active duty as he is at the present time and was not available to be nominated. As soon as he is available, we will convene a special board nominating committee and submit his name to the board of directors in accordance with our bylaws to be elected to the board. Mr. Chairman, I would also like to take this opportunity to report on a special board nominating committee that met on October 6, 2016, to select a board member to fill the unexpired term of the late Captain Bob Sila, a distinguished member of our board. The special nominating committee was chaired by Lieutenant General Ed Hanlon, with Colonel Bob Certain, Colonel Mike Rogers, Captain Gordon Van Hook, Captain Peter Trotson, Rear Admiral Claire Helminiak, and Rear Admiral Sam Thibault as members. Pursuant to your instruction, the committee considered five candidates who submitted applications for board membership during the 2016 election cycle. In order to maintain the required geographic representation on our board, The committee considered only those applicants who reside in Region 3, and Region 3 consists of Florida, South Carolina, and Georgia. The committee unanimously nominated Rear Admiral Richard A. Buchanan, United States Navy retired, and he was elected to the board in our meeting on Monday, October 24th, 2016. Mr. Chairman, that concludes my report.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. In view of the overwhelming vote in favor of the 11 officers nominated by the committee, I declare that they are elected. They will join Rear Admiral Buchanan to assume their duties later this morning. It's now my pleasure, as a result, to introduce to you these men and women who volunteered to serve on MOAA's board. Their names are in your program, but as General Lynch reads their names, I ask that they please come forward, and I ask that you please hold your applause until all the directors-elect have been identified.
First, Rear Admiral Robert E. Day, United States Coast Guard retired. Please come forward and stand when we can introduce you to the membership. We have Colonel Jerry I. Graham, United States Army retired. We have Brigadier General Allison A. Hickey, United States Air Force retired. Unfortunately, General Hickey cannot be with us this morning. From Minnesota, we have Captain Matthew W. Kusky, United States Army retired. From Oregon, we have Colonel Mary J. Mayer, United States Air Force retired. From Arizona, we have Lieutenant General John F. Regney, United States Air Force retired. From Virginia, we have Lieutenant Colonel Ernest E. Robinson, United States Marine Corps Reserve. From Virginia, we also have Lieutenant Colonel Walter J. Smiley, United States Army. From Washington, we have Captain Peter Trodson, United States Coast Guard retired. From Massachusetts, we have Rear Admiral Gary R. White, United States Navy retired. And from Florida, we have Rear Admiral Richard A. Buchanan, United States Navy retired. Sir, these are our new members of the board.
I've been snake bit, but did we get Andy McCauley? Sorry.
I did neglect one. We have Captain Andrew McCauley, United States Navy retired. I'm sorry, Andy.
He asked for special recognition. Thanks, ladies and gentlemen. You may return to your seats. Okay, we're ready now to open the floor to new business. If you have anything that you'd like to bring to the attention of the board or any questions you'd like to add the board or the staff, president, general counsel, CFO, government relations, please make yourself known to one of the staff members who have a microphone, and when you begin, tell us who you are, where you're from, and give us your question. There's one down front here, I see. You might stand up so these, oh, there she comes. Thanks, Nancy.
My name is John Cox, Northern Virginia chapter of the board from 1988 to 1994. My question is, the investment account, what is in it these days, and is it managed in-house or taking money managers?
Jim?
Thank you for that question. It's a very important part of our responsibilities, as you know, as a board and a staff, to protect the resources of MOAA. In 2010, prior to 2010, the investment portfolio was primarily managed in-house with a variety of mutual funds and individual bonds. At that time, the board suggested, after a couple of challenging investments, to look at outsourcing our fixed income portfolio, which we did in 2010. And over the next couple of years, we shifted our full portfolio to alternatives next in 2011, and then in 2012, our equity as well. So our entire portfolio is managed with a firm, and basically they form a They have fiduciary responsibilities to us and report to our board on a quarterly basis on the execution of the investments and the investment performance.
What's a percentage breakdown between fixed income and equities?
So we've again changed our guidelines on that in terms of we give them ranges. The portfolio size right now is about $114 million. Right now we have about 20% of that in fixed income. A lot of that decision was driven by the fact, as you're all well aware, of the low returns in the fixed income environment. We have a range as far as what can be alternative investments, which, as you know, could be hedge funds and private equity and so forth. And then the remainder of the portfolio is in equities.
How have you done the last 5 years?
So over the last, I would say the last 10 years, our returns have been averaging around 6 years. The last 5 years, I'm sorry.
6%.
Yeah, about 6%, yes. But as you know, it varies greatly from year to year. I mean, in 2010, you know, in 2010, we were double digit returns. And then 2011 was a little bit of a negative year. 2014 and 15, for example, were single-digit returns, low single digits.
Probably a better question would have been, how have you done compared to the market?
Well, compared, the board just conducted, this board, as a matter of fact, a review comparing ourselves against, you know, other organizations using the company that we are with. And we've done we've done very well overall for a like portfolio, for a diversified portfolio with a strategy that we use, which is pretty much a core and satellite approach. We've kind of transitioned a lot of the portfolio to more passive investments to keep the fees down. So the board took a holistic look at not only return performance, but fees, service, and access to evaluate the portfolio.
I think you can say part of the bottoms-up review, and I'll tiptoe lightly through this, part of the bottoms-up review was to adjust our expectations as the market flattened last year, and basically it's been flat with a couple of dips that scared the bejesus out of us, to adjust our expectations of return out of that market. And so right now we're basing our budget on for 2017 on 6% return out of the market. And I'm planning, and I said there's work to do over the next 2 to 4 years, planning to adjust that expectation further downward based on the advice of a lot of veteran investors in New York, down to 5% or so. Right now, I think Jim can report that we're on track to make our 6% this year. But we don't know what the market's going to do post-election. So that's why we caveat everything we do, because post-election, the market will either go this way or that. I mean that way, and we'll have to. And I think I can say we're generally prepared to withstand some of that turbulence for a little while, more than a little while, maybe, because of the way we've structured our funds. Probably get more privately. I don't want to get too far out on the end of this plank that I'm walking out on, but I am confident in saying that as we leave, the board, the current class and the next two classes and the new class who's been oriented this week, are very sensitive to monitoring this portfolio because the $115 million corpus that we have is a good chunk of what we live off of. And the future of MOAA depends on how we manage that, so that every year we have, our life member reserves are invested, and we can pull down those mathematically every year based on what a life member would give and as if he paid annual dues. So it's important to us to be able to sustain MOAA for the long term, and I'm talking about 50 or 100 years, and that's the kind of timeline we're looking at. Jim, you might want to also, did you touch scholarship fund? Because it's as important.
Right, our scholarship fund now, when you look at it, we're over a $100 million fund now. As many of you know, we have a loan program, so many of the assets for that are out in accounts receivables for our student loans of about $50 million, but we now have about $50 million invested as well, continuing that program on, and that's what allowed, as General Atkins briefed, for us to continue to improve the impact that we have to more and more students. So it's been a very successful program and done well investment-wise also.
Continues to be successful. I mean, we've gone in my tenure from probably an $80 million scholarship fund to right now about $107 million scholarship fund, mostly based on your donations and some very kind bequests that we got from former MOAA members. So it's really been a true success story. One more? Yeah, go ahead, John. Yes, sir. Yes, sir, absolutely. Yes, I don't know what the numbers are.
Yes, we do. It actually varies from year to year, but we're usually somewhere between 10 and 15% go to enlisted children.
But it's important, to make sure you know. So we have a $107 million scholarship fund, and as Jim said, about half of it in interest-free loans. And the way we structure our loans, we have a very, very respectable payback. We almost don't write off a loan unless a student is killed or dies. But truth in lending, when you get out your checkbook to make your donation to the scholarship fund this year, however you do it, with $106.7 million, if I remember the numbers right, scholarship fund, we're only able to meet one-third of the qualified applicants for the scholarship fund. So we'd like to do better than that. To the right, sir. Other questions?
Sir, good morning. John Lally, Suncoast Chapter, Incorporated 4.
Oh, you're the lights. Oh, there you are.
I have two questions. First of all, as you know, relevance is a big buzzword. And MOAA, like any of the other service organizations, needs to remain relevant. First question has to do with the concurrent receipt of VA disability and the SSI or VSP, SSI specifically, VSI, variable separation incentive that started back in the early 90s. I've talked to a number of veterans in our area that have now reached that retirement age, they're getting their VA disability, and what's happening is they're taking the VSI funds back. You know, we have concurrent receipt of disability and retired pay, but they're taking, recovering the VSI funds now, in receipt of the VSI.
Sure.
So that's the first question, is where does MOAA stand on that? Is it even on the radar screen? And the second is the early retirement of reservists of the National Guard. As you know, Congress passed a law that allowed reservists of the National Guard, we call that duty during the war, to retire early based on their service, but in their efforts, they only went back to January of 2008. So for all of those veterans who were called back that duty from 9/11 to 2008, didn't fall under the, and I understand it's a budget thing, we're in a tight budget environment, but I'm just curious whether either one of those issues are on the radar screen for more.
Yeah, I wouldn't understand it if I were you. I mean, it's something that, Steve?
Yes, sir. Yes, they're definitely on our radar. Every year, and as a matter of fact, in the January magazine, you'll see a list of all of our goals, and all of those things are in there. There's a concurrent receipt problem, not just for VA disability retirement and or VA disability compensation and retired pay, and not just for the SBP DIC survivors, but there are a range of issues with the VSI, which is the voluntary separation incentive that was used during the drawdown. With separation pay, all of those things have to be paid back if you either qualify for VA disability compensation or if you serve in the reserves and later start drawing reserve retired pay. And so there's the objective is to get rid of all of those. The problem is that Congress has passed rules called mandatory spending rules that if you want to increase retired pay, you have to come up with an equal reduction in either retired pay or TRICARE for life or survivor benefits in order to offset it. And that's a huge challenge for the Armed Services Committees in addressing the issue for the survivors this year. We're taking that issue to the House and Senate leaders to urge that they provide some additional funds for the Armed Services Committee, since it's so hard for the Armed Services Committees to deal with it. And those are issues that we just haven't been able to get to at this point, very frankly. I think we're gonna have to wait for a more favorable budget environment. It seems like that's never gonna come, but at some point it will, and I believe those will be addressed eventually. Including the issue about the going back to the early reserve retirement credit for people who served between 2001 and 2008. That's crazy. You know, when Congress passed the law, it was effective 2008. They made it prospective. There's a lot of things like that that we need to make retroactive to make it equitable.
That answer your question?
Yes.
Don't be satisfied. You help us work the issue. Next question.
Good morning, sir. My name is Jim Rubin. I'm from the Southeast North Carolina chapter.
Jim?
You've touched briefly on the revenue, and you also touched briefly on your aspiration goal of 6% on the return on investment versus a more realistic 5%. What are your expectations in reducing expenses to bring them in line with revenue?
That's a good question. Let's see. I'll let Jim start.
Well, as General Atkins briefed, we conducted the bottom-up review, and that's exactly what we've done. We've reduced several million dollars from expenses, and in fact, if you look at where we were in 2008, what our budget was, and you price it for today's dollars, we've gone from a budget priced out in 2008 of about $27 million down to roughly $21 million. That's pretty impressive use of resources. We've had to reduce a little bit of our staff, but we've also really focused on our missions to be more into our core competencies. So we've done a lot. In fact, I believe we've done most of our emphasis on the cost side. The real question going forward is to continue to work the revenue side, as General Atkins has mentioned, to try to find other revenue sources to alleviate some of the stress on investments. And also, collectively, as we work towards bringing in, as General Atkins says, asking people to join our association to bring our dues up for a membership that can support some of the many things that we're trying to do. Anything else?
You know, it's this whole effort, as you would expect, is ongoing. It's not something that we just did once and then put it on the shelf like this. Jim mentioned, I think, even General Robertson has mentioned, we carved in this past year we carved almost nearly $3 million off the budget and continue on a glide path that is sustainable, you know, based on predicted return rates of about 6%. On the revenue side, again, we're doing things in the backdrop right now. We have renegotiated a contract with advertising, which has been more lucrative for us. I say us all in this room like this. We're relooking some of the royalty programs. I mentioned in my briefing about the new travel service. The travel service, we hope, again, will be fairly generous to MOAA, both here at the national level and at the chapter level, with returns, commission returns, based on the utility of those services as well. So kind of a collective effort, not only to do the cost reduction, but also to stimulate additional revenue sources.
The other thing that I would add is, as you know, investment expectations, not just a unique problem to MOAA. It's really, you've read retirement pension funds, many other companies, other nonprofits have dealt with this longstanding accepted number of an 8% return. That's just not a number that we felt as a board and a staff that was sustainable. The challenge is when you reduce from that, as you know, and as your question implies, something else has to give. Either you have to replace it with additional revenue, or you have to decrease costs. But really, if you look at it, it's pretty impressive that within 2 years, we've gone from an 8% expectation already down to 6%. So yes, we all agree we have further to go, but it was a pretty big effort to get from 8 to 6, and that's over the long term going to put us in a better position.
And I'll add one more. So when we did the bottoms-up review, we looked at everything that MOAA does. We talked about that, everything that MOAA does. And then we prioritized. And we actually had a voting process where we voted and said, okay, this is higher than this, this is higher than this. And then we played the game that the Department of Defense says, you know, said, well, this is really important to us, but it's not quite as high to save it in whole, but maybe we can carve out a piece of it and save it. And we're also looking, you know, maybe someday, add backs. But we've got an add back list, and we're telling anybody that wants to add back, you know, if you're a programmer or have been, bring your offset, because nothing gets added back without taking something out. But when we did the bottoms up review, the programs that we looked at reducing or eliminating, to be perfectly blunt about it, were programs that span 2016 and 2017. So what you have seen so far, the results that Jim and Dana and I talked about, were 2016 chunk of that, but the 2017, which is admittedly smaller than what we took in 2016, is baked into the 2017 budget. And so as the market goes one way or the other way, and as we measure the impact of what we've done to MOAA programs, and I'll promise you, nothing in the advocacy area got touched. Membership only got nicked. Councils and chapters only got nicked. These were programs that probably are invisible to you, that because they weren't really core to MOAA's mission. But I suspect, and I leave, you know, the board here shortly, but I suspect there will not be need for another bottoms-up review, but continued close scrutiny at what MOAA does and how it prioritizes the things that it does. And you can help with that. Okay, yes, ma'am.
So Joy, soldiers who serve on active duty, retire, and have their full benefits. If they have deployed, they're considered veterans. If you've served and retired, if you've not deployed, you're not a veteran. Is this something that MOAA is considering addressing, or is that on your radar at all?
Yes, ma'am. Jim, Steve?
Yes, it definitely is. We've been pushing legislation on that for several years. It, for those who aren't familiar with it, it doesn't provide any extra benefits, but it includes these guardsmen and reservists who've just never happened to be called to active duty under Title 10 orders. It acknowledges their veteran status. And it's frustrating because we've gotten the Senate to pass it before and then the House didn't. We've gotten the House to pass it and then the Senate didn't, or they pass it in different legislation and they don't seem to ever get it resolved. That's one of the things we're still hoping might happen during the lame duck session, because there are a couple of bills out there, again, that have passed separate chambers. It's just, I think it's only a matter of time. You know, it kind of falls victim to some of the bigger issues and the bigger arguments between the House and Senate.
You know, it's interesting. I would say the questions that you're throwing up, certainly in the government relations and legislative affairs area, are what I and the board does to Steve and DT every day, because you read an article in the paper from the Fayetteville Times or the Los Angeles and send an email up and says, are we tracking this? And the answer is routinely, I mean 100% always yes. But keep testing them. Now on the flip side, you've heard the answers. And many of you, maybe even most of you, have stormed with us. And you know that when we storm, we, just like everything else, we have to prioritize what we're going to go over there in mass to plead with our congressmen and senators to fix. And so all of these issues are worked every day by Steve and his talented team of lobbyists. But at the same time, we also, as we go over and work behind closed door, they'll say, okay, well, is this more important to you or is this more important to you? And those decisions are made within MOAA, and sometimes we say, okay, well, we'll wait to next year on this one, but fix this one now. I mean, I don't want to put words in your mouth, Steve, but a simplified approach to how the process works, and you, and I'm sure you expect that. Yes, sir. Ma'am.
Thank you. Marie Sendick, President of Coastal Carolina Chapter. We're a small chapter. We do give out JROTC maps and awards, and there was some discussion that one of the things that you have cut out funding with your budget reallocation, so the chapters are going to bear the cost of getting those maps. Yes?
You want to take it, DT?
Yeah, that.
Sir, I'm going to address that at the upcoming roundtable. Marie, if it's okay, in about 15 minutes, we're going to have about an hour and a half to talk about it.
Somebody will have to tell me. I'm in the focus. So.
Okay, all right.
Thank you.
Okay, that's a common question, and one that we wrestle with on a regular basis. But Barry is the expert, DT is next, and Jim is next. Okay, I think I'm going to take one more question, and then I'll refer you to the board members and the staff you see across in the room. One more question. Who gets the mic first? Yes, sir.
Yeah, Bill Severance, Low Country, South Carolina.
Bill?
What are we doing, or what are you all doing, to entice the younger people to join MOAA? I know a lot of other organizations that I'm involved in, we don't have joiners anymore.
Yeah. Yeah, let me tell you one thing, and Kathy Parton's probably out there somewhere, but I'll let DT, who's our new marketing expert with all of his new social media talent, but one of the things that I've been kind of proud of, when you look at the MOAA membership curve, going back to the TROA days, our numbers are kind of similar. Now, we're not growing, but you heard DT talk about the National Association of Uniformed Services. They're shutting down, and they've asked us to absorb their membership because they're having the same problem. Plus, they can't afford, the market has hit them so bad that they can't afford to stay in business. But the interesting thing is if you watch that curve and break it out by, I don't know, the new word is persona, but groups, the World War II generation used to be way over here on the left, and it was, and the spike was way up here, and it came down and came down and came down. Korea bounced up and came down, Vietnam bounced. And so those groups have come and gone, and I won't say come and gone because I'm one of them, but they've been absorbed by new members and a significant number are currently serving. I mean, I thought we had no currently serving. And I would say that probably fully a fourth, and I'm hanging it out there a little bit, fully a fourth of our membership is currently serving now. Now, I'm going to, because I'm not minimizing the problem, it is a major, major, major challenge for all associations, including MOAA. That's why we've ramped up our social media. I mean, I had to go on Facebook, and I thought I would never do that. But that's the kind of thing we're talking about. I'll let DT approach it because it's a critical importance to the future of MOAA.
You know, I heard the same thing. Somebody one time told me, you know, this is a generation that doesn't say thank you, they don't RSVP, and they don't join. And I don't think we agree with that. I mean, they don't. That's not them, whatever it is like this. But they simply are attracted by different things than many of us in this room right now. And in fact, Kathy and the marketing team has done a remarkable job of kind of slicing out, segmenting what we call personas, trying to figure out, you know, what are the profiles, what are the, you know, inclinations of certain kind of groups out there. But the biggest thing for MOAA right now is to make an investment. And the investment is really, it's in how do we really, you know, engage with them. You know, many of us, you know, our engagement strategy is picking up a newspaper or we get the magazine or something like this. And we know where they're at. You know, they're all on social media. They're all on new smartphones. I had the opportunity one time to walk into a hotel in Denver, Colorado. They just had hosted the regional women's Division I volleyball tournament. When I walked in, the entire hotel lobby and atrium was full of women all over 6 foot tall, of course. But they all had the phones in their hands like this. And we know, and we don't do, I mean, again, we do, but we don't do a really good job. You know, we have some social media presence right now, Facebook, Twitter, but we're very, very, I would say, we're very, very kind of immature in that strategy, so we're trying to do that as well. The other thing, too, is, again, you know, the whole engagement strategy, there is an aspect of advertising and marketing, so we're pursuing some of that piece as well like this. You know, the younger generation, I said the other day, if you have the right activity or the right event, they show up in the hundreds. If you have a 10K run, you know, they show up in the hundreds. If Mrs. Smith, who's been wheelchair bound for the last month and can't do her landscaping, and you say, well, let's just get over to Mrs. Smith's house on Saturday and do her landscaping, they're there by the hundreds. So we have to figure out the events and the activities that draw them as well like this. We know that the younger officers, many of them are doing career transitions of their own. They're moving from the military to the public and private sector. So what can we do in a stronger, more impactful way to help them navigate that transition? And we're kind of going down that strategy as well. And the other connection to that younger generation is their families. Their families, their children. I mean, a lot of spouse support activities, a lot of children activities that we wouldn't traditionally have not traditionally done. So the landscape's pretty wide right now, but it certainly is being addressed right now by our marketing team in a very strong way, by our chapters and councils as well, but more importantly, looking at an investment strategy to make sure that we're making investments so that, in fact, we can optimize the strategy that we're trying to seek.
Good enough? Okay, let me wrap this up. Suzanne just stepped up and gave me additional announcements. As we wrap up and head off to the workshops and other portions of our board meeting, I encourage you to do a couple of things. Visit our exhibitors. I mean, they support us financially, plus they bring some very good products to the table out in the lobby. So please stop by and see them and talk to them and thank them for their support of MOAA, if nothing else. There are three current workshops to follow, a chapter roundtable in the concourse room presented by MOAA's chapter affairs team. Barry, I think you're leading that one. Technology, scams, and your privacy. I'd like to have time to do that myself. And the Cavalier B&C presented by SeniorNet, technology, scams, and your privacy. And the top 10 MOAA issues of 2016 in Cavalier A presented by Shane Ostrom. Lunch is at noon in this ballroom. And our keynote speaker is motivational speaker Dan Clark. I think you'll really enjoy him. Thank you all. I think we've now completed the agenda for our annual meeting. I hope it's been useful. I hope your questions to the staff will follow. But thank you for attending our annual meeting, and we are adjourned.